morning, I'm Chris Cooney, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the first Good Morning Metro South of the new year, 2017. Happy New Year to everyone. We are delighted to be on the beautiful campus of Stonehill College. We are so fortunate to have Stonehill, along with so many colleges and universities within the Metro South region. They are vibrant places and are active with the Metro South Chamber, virtually all of them. Massasoit Community College, Eastern Nazarene, Fisher College, and Curry College all have presence right here in the city of Brockton. While Bridgewater State University, UMass Boston, and UMass Dartmouth are nearby, imagine their collective economic impact on our state and region. Millions in budgets each year supporting thousands of employees, contractors, and facilities. Dollars spent locally educating tens of thousands of students who will go on to earn higher wages and support the local economy. Today we are pleased to feature two of our wonderful institutions of higher education, Stonehill College and the University of Massachusetts at Dartmouth. Please join me in welcoming our host and MC, Fran Dillon from Stonehill College.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Martin Institute for Law and Society. This building was the result of a federal grant to Stonehill back around 1988, and it's provided a great resource for the college to share with the community. This year, we're looking forward to going back to the federal government to get a reauthorization of the bill for the Martin Institute. My suggestion to the president was that we change the name from the Martin Institute, named after Joe Martin, who was Speaker of the House back in the 40s and the 50s, to Trump Tower, giving us a little edge and getting some support. But anyways, you're very, very welcome here to Stonehill this morning. And I'd like to begin by making some introductions. The first group of people I will introduce are members of the board of the Chamber of Commerce, and we're pleased to have us with us this morning. Chairman Jerry Nadeau from Rockland Trust. Welcome, Jerry. Our immediate past chairman, Sue Joss from the Brockton Neighborhood Health Center. Also, a person who will be having a role this morning in interviewing our sponsor, Marsa Kanbabe, Vice Chairman of Community Affairs from Kanbabe Immigration Law. Also, Joe Casey from Harbor One and Pat Ciamella from Old Colony Planning Council. So welcome to fellow board members here this morning. We also have a group of wonderful ambassadors that are the heart and soul of this chamber and who always make us feel welcome wherever the chamber is hosting an event. So please stand when I call your name and if you can hold your applause until the end. John King, Ceres Inc. Joanne Schneider, Eastern Bank. Rico McNeil, Bridgewater Savings Bank. Catherine Light, Mansfield Bank. Brian Hoffman, Eastern Children's Museum. Murray Vetstein, Source 4. Richard Hook, Crescent Credit Union. Dan Jeanette, TD Bank, Brenda Karens, OCES, Gail Delgado, Brockton Area ARC, and Robert Sansone, Heartland. Please welcome members of the We have several elected officials with us, and we're very pleased to have you with us this morning. State Representative Jerry Cassidy from the 9th Plymouth District. Welcome, Jerry. Ann Beauregard, Brockton City Councilor. And representing Senator Brady, Mr. Jean Durancourt. Welcome, John. Great to have you here. And the rest of you are also very important, so give yourself a round of applause. And Happy New Year. I don't know how much longer we say that. I figure I say it as long as I'm keeping my New Year's resolutions. So this is the last day I mentioned Happy New Year. I actually didn't make any resolutions this year because last year my resolution was to lose 10 pounds. So if I lose 15 pounds this year, I'll make up for last year's, so I have a ways to go. But 2016 was quite a year for all of us. Personally, it was a wonderful year for me, and I think I told some of you back in the summer when I did this that we married off our daughter, which was wonderful, and our son and daughter-in-law had our first grandchild. And I must tell you, being a grandparent is just quite an absolute joy, to not only to see a little baby grow into a little human being, but to see a son or a daughter become a parent. It's just amazing. You know, I think it's God's way of rewarding parents for not killing their kids when they were teenagers. So if you happen to have teenagers or are going to have teenagers, bear with me, it's worth it if you get through those years. The last thing I want to say as part of my introduction is what a great weekend this is going to be. No, not inauguration, I'm talking about the Patriots-Steelers. That's going to be quite an event. I have somebody on my staff who's actually from Pittsburgh, and all I hear about is how wonderful Pittsburgh is. And he said to me the other day, you know, Pittsburgh is that great city where the mighty Monongahela River and the powerful Allegheny River join to form the Ohio River. And I said, oh, really? Well, I'm from Greater Boston, and that's where the Mystic River and the Charles River come together to form the Atlantic Ocean. So there. Now, it's indeed my pleasure to introduce, again, attorney Marsa Kenbabe of Kenbabe Immigration Law, who will be interviewing Stonehill's own Deb Salvucci. Deb is the chair of the Business Administration Department at Stonehill and has recently been announced as the new dean of the School of Business here at Stonehill. So please welcome Marsa and Deb Salvucci. As they're approaching the stage, I'd like to take a minute to tell you a little bit about Professor Salvucci. She has been teaching accounting and taxation courses at Stonehill since 1985. She was 9 when she started teaching at Stonehill. Can you believe she's been teaching since 1985? She also has served as the Faculty Director of Business Administration's internship program since 1988. In 2007, she was appointed the department chairperson and successfully led the business department's effort to achieve the nationally recognized accreditation by the AACSB, American Association of Collegiate Schools of Business. And we're one of the few strictly undergraduate schools in the country to receive such accreditation. And a lot of that goes to Debbie's talent. Debbie is a certified public accountant and a tax practitioner. She serves on the Council of Women of Boston College and is the treasurer of the Board of Directors for South Shore Stars. So please welcome Professor Deborah Salvucci.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming out on this rainy day. So good morning, Professor Salvucci, and congratulations on your new post. That's very exciting.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
So please, why don't you start off by telling us about this new School of Business?
Yeah, so, you know, Stonehill was started in 1948. And in 1949, actually, the college began offering classes in business administration. It wasn't until the 70s that we started adding more majors in accounting, and then in the 80s in finance, marketing, management, and finally in the 90s in international business. Stonehill, as you know, nationally is known as a liberal arts college. And therefore, the fact that we have this very strong business program with very successful business alums gets a little lost in that as a liberal arts college, you know, if you are looking for a school that has a strong business program, you might not find Stonehill. So therefore, the restructuring into two schools, which will happen July 1st, into a School of Business and School of Arts and Sciences, will actually redefine and strengthen the programmatic identity and visibility of the programs here at Stonehill, more as a comprehensive college, right? We have business, we have all of these majors in business, marketing, accounting, finance, international business, and management? And so, you know, this restructuring will really provide prominence and visibility for the business program that to date is probably lacking, I would say. in that when I go to conferences around the country and I say I'm from Stonehill College as a business person, a lot of people say, oh, I didn't know Stonehill had business, or where is Stonehill College? So I think it'll be extremely helpful in not only strengthening the identity of business education here at Stonehill, but also provide visibility and prominence to the great work we've done in business education here at Stonehill. We have many, many, many successful alums who have graduated, who have done incredible things, and I think it'll give us an opportunity to highlight those our programs and our alums and really the great work we do in business education at Stonehill.
That's exciting. As an Easton resident, I'm really excited to hear about this. So thank you very much for all these improvements. What impact will having the School of Business have on current and future students?
So the fact that you strengthen your programming, you strengthen the reputation of the school, allows you to bring onto campus employers that want to hire your graduates, employers that want to offer internships for your students, because obviously the more successful the programs are, the more prominent that the programs are, the more excited, especially in the local area and nationally, you know, companies are to come to campus to hire our students. Now, we've had a lot of success in our accounting program. Our accounting program has always been very, very successful in that the big four and a lot of local firms come to campus, hire our students. Our accountants are extremely successful. They go on to becoming CFOs and CEOs. But we need to really improve employment opportunities for all of our students, especially in the management field, maybe marketing, a little bit in finance. And so having a School of Business will allow for us to have as I said, a higher profile and be able to attract more employers to Stonehill. And we're hoping employers that have a presence throughout the country. We're getting more and more students that come from other parts of the country. As you probably know, the demographics in this area have been decreasing for 18-year-olds, and therefore, in order for Stonehill to continue to be successful, we really need to attract students from other parts of the country. If in order to do that, if we have companies that are coming to Stonehill to hire our students, and bring more of a national name to Stonehill College, then we'll be able to attract more students from outside of the Northeast, where we have primarily gotten most of our students over the last, you know, 50, 60, 70 years. So.
Thank you. And what programs will be housed in this new school?
So not only will the business majors be housed in the school, but also healthcare administration and economics. We feel that these programs together will work closely together, can work closely together. Of course, our healthcare administration program is also certified, nationally certified as an undergraduate healthcare administration program, where our students combine business courses with science courses and go out and have administrative positions in the healthcare industry. And then the economics program, we have economics faculty that will be able to work with the business faculty and the finance faculty to improve the finance and the economics program. So we're excited to have economics and healthcare joining accounting, finance, marketing, management, and international business. We also have minors in entrepreneurship, management information systems, and we have a business administration minor that we encourage many of our humanities students to enroll in, so that they have not only their, say, history or English major, but a business background too, which certainly helps when they go out for, you know, look for a job upon graduation. We're going to start a program, too. The first session will be this Saturday for sophomores, where we get sophomores thinking about what are you going to do after graduation? Think about what did you think coming into Stonehill was going to be a career you would be interested in pursuing, and therefore we're going to have them think over the next couple of years about what skills they will need in order to enter that profession, and then guide them to the specific skills and courses they should take in order to get the required skills necessary to enter that profession. So we think that's going to be extremely helpful to all Stonehill students, and you know, the business program is going to be a big part of that.
Thank you. And the last question, will you be adding a master's program?
Actually, we are going to start our first master's program in 2018. As you probably know, Stonehill has pretty much been an undergraduate-only institution all these years. We had one master's in accountancy program back in 99 to 2008, which for accreditation reasons, we discontinued. There's a lot of competition in the area for MSA programs, too. So, the program where the graduate program that we're going to start in 2018 is an integrated marketing communications program. So based on research that has been done by our institutional research people, and a company that advises higher education institutions, we determined that there was demand for this type of program, that in the Boston area there aren't, there's one or two other programs, but that in southeastern Massachusetts there would be a demand for this program. So we're very excited. It combines marketing, communications, and graphic design. We had focus groups come in. We had alums and other people who work in this profession that have gone to a couple of schools in the Boston area that have these programs, say, yes, absolutely, there's a need for this, there's a demand for this, there aren't enough programs in the area, and we're hoping to be successful with this program. I will be meeting with the provost of Stonehill in the next month. We're going to talk about the next graduate program we'll probably be offering. I'll keep you in suspense. I don't know if I want to tell you what it is right now. But the thing is about, you know, when you have a 2,500 student population, undergraduate only institution, where obviously higher education is a tough industry to be in these days. And, you know, you have the pressures of raising tuition and how far you can raise tuition, how much you can raise tuition by, you know, expenses. Parents always ask me, why does tuition always go up every year? Why does it cost so much for college? And, you know, if you look around, you look at technology, you look at, you know, classrooms and updating classrooms for 21st century education. You look at amenities that, you know, it's almost like keeping up with the Joneses. And then you look at regulations and, you know, I've been here 32 years and I look at some of the departments that we need to have because of the regulation and a lot of the paperwork that needs to be done when you're in this business. And you realize that you can't keep squeezing the students, right? So therefore, we're hoping that having new revenue streams by adding some graduate programs will help. Also, we're hoping that with this entire reorganization that for fundraising purposes that not only will we have more employment opportunities, but that, you know, our alums will be very excited about what we're doing and continue to be excited about what we're doing and get more fundraising opportunities so that it would ease the burden on the students, provide some financial aid and ease the financial burden on our students. So.
Thank you so much, Professor Salvucci, and congratulations on your new position.
Thank you.
Thanks, Deb, and thanks, Marcia, for that wonderful interview. Before I introduce this morning's guest speaker, I want to remind you that you have green cards on your table. And if you have any questions now or as our speaker presents to you, please write them down and members of the chamber staff will collect them. And at the end of his presentation, we'll have a chance to at least address some of these questions. So it is indeed a pleasure to welcome to Stonehill College and the Metro South Chamber of Commerce our guest speaker this morning, Dr. Michael Goodman. Michael is a professor of public policy, executive director of the Public Policy Center, and acting chair of the Department of Public Policy at the University of Massachusetts, Dartmouth. Professor Goodman joined the faculty of UMass Dartmouth in 2009. I am pressing no buttons up here. Back to Michael. After serving for 8 years as the Director of Economic and Public Policy Research at UMass Donahue Institute, between 2009 and 2014, he served as the Chair of the Department of Public Policy and the Graduate Program Director of the Masters of Public Policy Program. A leading analyst of Massachusetts economy, he has authored or co-authored over 50 professional publications in a wide range of public policy issues, including regional economic development and housing policy, as well as demographic and other applied social science research topics. He has supported this research by generating over $5 million in external grant and contract funding from a diverse array of public and private sources. Dr. Goodman earned a master's degree and a Ph.D. degree at Boston University. He is also titled an economic sociologist. I once asked somebody, what's the difference between an accountant and an economist? And they told me an economist has a personality. No offense, Deb. So an economic sociologist must be an accountant with a personality and a sense of humor. Please welcome Dr. Michael Goodman.
I'm not sure I can live up to that introduction. I'm an economic sociologist. I was about 6 months ago introduced at another event in front of some realtors where the person who was reading the introduction said, introduced me as an economic socialist, which kind of killed the buzz in the room a bit. And so I couldn't help but say at that time, I'm not an economic socialist, I'm an economic sociologist, but I do like to share, and I have a few thoughts to share with you this morning. I'm going to hold forth on my perspective on the state of the state economy in the context of a very interesting set of times that we find ourselves living in. I'm going to focus for the most part on what's going on here in Massachusetts and drill down to regional trends where the data permit, and then try to conclude by highlighting some of the headwinds on the horizon, some of the challenges facing the state that we have some control over that may be constraining or hindering our growth, and then try to conclude with some perspective on what the incoming Trump administration may mean for Massachusetts and particularly our fiscal condition. To begin, I think we have to start off by recognizing that when you take a step back and you look at the recent economic performance of the state of Massachusetts, we're going through, at least at the state level, what is undeniably the most robust period of economic expansion and job growth in this century that we're now 17, 16 plus years into. As you can see here, and you'll forgive me if I lean a bit, we had a bit of a run-up in the 90s. Those of you that were paying attention at the time remember, we had the dot-com bubble, which at the end of the last century peaked just before 9/11. We were extra exposed here in Massachusetts to that bubble because we're so much of a leader, a world and national leader in information technology and high technology and innovation. And so when the wheels came off that bus in 2000 and 2001, we fell first, further, and farther and lost a substantial amount of employment, as you can see in that first little mini ski jump that occurs in what was otherwise a very modest recession nationally. It took us a long time to begin to crawl back. As you can see, by the time we got to the Great Recession, which for a number of different reasons started a bit later here and was not quite as severe. Obviously, mileage varies within the regions of the state. Certainly, the city of Brockton and the area felt more than its fair share of pain associated with the housing crisis and the associated foreclosures that I know continue to be, to a lesser extent, a challenge here. But we never really regained the jobs that we had lost in the run-up of that dot-com bubble at the end of the 90s. Coming out of that recession in late 2009 and early 2010, the state really outpaced the nation, which has had stronger recoveries, to be sure, but has been growing. The United States has faster than the rest of the world, which isn't necessarily saying very much, but relatively speaking, the nation has been doing better than the globe, and the state has been doing significantly better than the nation. As you can see, we're now at a higher level of employment than we've seen for certainly back to the turn of the century, which I think is quite impressive. The glass half empty version of the story is that did it take us 12 or 13 years to regain all the jobs that were lost at the end of the dot-com bubble? The answer is yes. So we had a very slow start to the century, but we've been making up for lost ground since, although it's been quite regionally imbalanced. Our headline unemployment rate at the state level is now below 3%, which is well below, I think, anybody's assessment of what full employment is. So we find ourselves in certain particularly hot areas of the Commonwealth with spot shortages of labor, particularly in the greater Boston area, where recently a commercial real estate person told me that the vacancy rate in Cambridge is now zero, not low, but nothing. So there may be some subdivisions and other new developments coming, but there are parts of the state that are white hot in terms of real estate and job markets. But if you take a look at who's been left behind and you take a step back and look at the broadest definition of unemployment in Massachusetts, that includes the people who are out of work, the people who have been would like a job but have stopped looking because they don't feel like they can find one, and the people who are working part-time for economic reasons, that is, they would prefer a full-time position but can only obtain a part-time position. We still have, I think it says, what is that, 8.3? I can't really make it out from here. It's certainly significantly higher than that headline rate. And so in certain populations and in certain regions of the state, unemployment continues to be a problem. I think this in part explains some of the anger we saw in the last election. I think it's justified in certain regions of the country, in certain regions of the state, and in certain population groups. It's been particularly difficult for people who were out of work for an extended period of time. There is still some indication that employers were seeing that long gap in the resume as some sort of signal of a problem in that applicant. And certainly over time, and we'll discuss this a bit more as I continue, the disadvantages of low levels of skill and educational attainment continue to pile up. So if you're a member of a group that has lower levels of education and skill, lower levels of experience in the labor force, it's been an incredibly difficult time. And for those of us who come from communities or who are interested in the development of communities that have more than their fair share of those problems, it doesn't always feel like the kind of recovery that guys like me stand up here and tell you about. If you take a look at where the jobs have been created in Massachusetts during the period, and this is a 7-year period that ends in September, it's been pretty broad-based, although that masks what was initially largely a white-collar recovery driven by professional and business services, education and health services, particularly on the private higher education side, notwithstanding more recent disruptions that were alluded to in the conversation that we were just had the privilege of listening to. So that was driving growth initially, but we've seen in the last 3 or 4 years a very strong bounce back in construction employment in particular, which has been growing very rapidly. There was a very long downturn in real estate development in Massachusetts, including in the now white-hot greater Boston area, where we had 5 or 6 years of very little development at all, lots of unemployment in the building and construction trades, and a lot of anecdotal evidence to suggest that a number of those workers moved into different fields, which helps to explain why it's difficult in some parts of the state where the real estate development is high to get the kind of workers that they need. But I think it's been encouraging that the industries that make up the growth drivers for the Massachusetts economy in the last few years have broadened a bit. But make no mistake, the economic destiny of the state continues to rely very heavily on innovation, on highly skilled and highly educated workers, and the rest of us essentially are dependent on the opportunities that are created by that growth. Consulting firms, accounting firms, engineering and design firms, retailers, realtors are all kind of living on the growth that's being generated by these innovative institutions in private and public higher education and research institutions in particular, in our teaching hospitals in particular, and certainly in our leading industries, information technology, defense contracting, advanced manufacturing. The maritime economy is a huge deal, particularly in southeastern Massachusetts and I'm keeping the islands. And so we've had a pretty broad-based experience. But I don't have to tell a crowd that's filled with representatives and leaders from one of the Commonwealth's leading gateway cities that mileage has varied pretty significantly from place to place. Even though income overall in Massachusetts has grown, that doesn't tell us very much at all about how it's been distributed. And many of the residents of our gateway cities who are home to disproportionately high shares of the less well-educated populations in our state, which, as I mentioned earlier, are having a more difficult time in the labor market and in this economic recovery, have not seen very much income growth at all. I think to the extent there's been lift, it does appear to be driven by recent increases in the minimum wage, which have driven some wage increases in the class of workers that are just above the minimum wage, which I think has been encouraging. We haven't seen any negative results in terms of job creation and economic activity, as some predicted. But if the gateway cities, the income of the gateway cities was growing as fast as it was for the state, there would be a substantially higher income level in cities like Brockton, in Fall River, in New Bedford, Holyoke, Springfield, and a number of the other cities across the state. There have been some cities that have outperformed. Worcester and Lowell come to mind. But they, in important ways, are connected to a number of these innovation and growth-driven industries in ways that cities like Brockton, Fall River, New Bedford, and Springfield have not been. They are home to university campuses and colleges in their very midst. They retain a middle-class population. They have relatively higher shares of home ownership. And they have ready and direct transportation connections to job opportunities in Greater Boston. The disconnection of the destinies of our cities, and certainly some of our rural areas as well, from the economic success that Massachusetts has experienced in recent years is not a new problem, but it has become more pronounced in recent years, and it's certainly an issue that our leaders are going to have to contend with in the years to come. One way of looking at how some of these regions and communities has been left behind is to look at the tax base, because obviously a lot of government and a lot of support and a lot of the institutions that create opportunities for our younger people and our next generation of workers and citizens and residents are a function of the capacity of our communities to provide them with a quality public education and safe streets and other appropriate public services. We have seen substantial recovery in real estate markets and, by extension, increases in the net growth in the tax base. That's not really been mirrored by the experiences of these cities. So when you don't have lots of new growth in your tax base, it means that the income that flows into the coffers of city government and into the school department stays the same unless you raise the rate, which obviously has some political implications and is hard to do at any level of government these days. Here in the Brockton area, if you look at the city, you can see that the city's tax base, according to a recent analysis by Moody's and the Department of Revenue here in Massachusetts, remains well below the level, the total property values that are taxable in Brockton as before the crisis, which means we're now, you know, we can date the crisis to about the third quarter of 2005, which I must say was when I bought my first home. So don't take my financial advice. And another lesson for you students of this topic is that having access to the data doesn't mean you always make the best decisions, but that'll be the last complaint I have about that choice. In any case, The communities that have been driving growth are the same communities that I mentioned earlier, those communities that ring Greater Boston, suburban communities that have experienced a lot of lift. I suspect Easton, as compared to Brockton, has been doing much better, has seen property values increase, tax bills increase, but tax rates remain level. That's what allows our suburban communities to invest more in their schools and to get more from them in many cases. So the tax base in a city like Brockton is overwhelmingly driven by residential property values, relatively limited commercial tax base. That certainly is something that city leaders and business leaders, including those represented here today and affiliated with the chamber here, are trying to push. But it's been a very difficult proposition across the state. And again, a lot of that has to do with what's been driving our economic growth and the lack of those growth drivers in many of our regions here in Massachusetts. Another illustration of this can be seen in development patterns. So those of you that find your way into the core Boston area daily may see the skyline filled with cranes, and there are certainly lots of multifamily development going on in that core area. I live in Waltham, where we're building $3,500 a month two-bedroom apartments like they're going out of style. So anybody who needs one of those, we've got some. But that's not really been filling in the gap in the local demand for housing. So a lot of the opportunities that a region like this has been able to capitalize on is the need that many of those working families and middle and upper income families have for a more affordable place to live that still offers them the opportunity to get into the job opportunities that are disproportionately concentrated there. As you can see, we don't build very much housing or permit very much housing in Massachusetts at all. We have a very quaint tradition here in New England of allowing our local communities to have absolute control over the use of the land, and they choose, for the most part, not to use it at all. That leads to inadequate amount supply of housing, which creates affordability problems. It helped protect us from the housing downturn in the places that weren't overbuilding, which is almost everywhere in Massachusetts. But in the years since, what we haven't seen in gateway cities is a recovery in that development activity. And so we've not yet gotten to the point where we're starting to see some lift in the demand for land in our urban areas outside of the core Boston area. I think we are right on the periphery here within and around the 495 belt. So all kinds of natural advantages presented by the access to roads and to rail that you all have here that many of your neighbors to the south, believe me, are very envious of. But that yet has yet to manifest in really significant amounts of commercial real estate development activity. Part of the reason, and I want to underscore this point because I think it's a challenge faced by this region and many others in Massachusetts, is a fundamental change that's been going on in the larger economy that has been increasing the returns to education and skill, particularly higher education. If you take a look at the left side, you can see that over the last generation or so, so I'm a Gen Xer, so I was born in the mid-60s, so since then the returns, the advantages of having a college degree have grown, both in absolute terms, in terms of the income that you can demand in the labor market, and the gap between that growth and the rise in incomes of people who don't have a college degree. Another way of putting it is, if we just do a simple ratio of the wages that are paid to a college graduate as opposed to a high school graduate, you can see that in the mid-70s, the high school graduate was able to earn about 80% of what the college graduate was able to earn. We're now getting close to about half. Most of that has to do with a significant change in the structure of our economy and the departure of jobs that didn't require lots of advanced training and skills but did pay reasonable wages. I recall having a conversation with a former AFL-CIO president here in Massachusetts who said when he was doing outplacement for the last Ford plant in Natick when it closed in the late 70s, we were at the tip of the deindustrialization trend here in Massachusetts, that he would look at people who had a middle-class income, single person, one person working in the house, put their kids through college, owned their own home, had a second home on the Cape, and when he did the outplacement, he said a lot of folks were basically functionally illiterate. They didn't have anything beyond the skills that they brought to that table. Those days, unfortunately, for the most part, are over, at least if you're going to live at that kind of a style of life that I don't know, I only have the one house, so, and as I mentioned earlier, I overpaid for it, so. The destiny of these communities is a complicated matter, but I think at the end of the day, if we were going to move one needle in places like Brockton, it would be on educational attainment. As I mentioned, the earning power of the high school graduate as compared to the college graduate has declined significantly. The outcomes for people who don't make it through high school at all are terrible, right? So folks end up either dependent on the outside looking in of the labor market, incarcerated, or worse. So that certainly costs society and those households and the communities where they reside substantially. This shows a simple scatter plot between the share of the population in some of our largest communities in Massachusetts that has a bachelor's degree or better and the local unemployment rate. As you can see, once you get into the Tony suburbs in the greater Boston area, the Brooklines and the Newtons, we're in the 70 to 80% and above have a college degree or better, have a negligible unemployment rate. When you get down to 2%, this is basically chart and churn. This is when people stop working at one place and start working at another rather than being displaced. You get up into the traditional gateway cities, including the one that I think is the focus of much of your attention here, and it's pretty clear that that lack of educational attainment and those relatively low levels of skill that serve, but values that serve this community well but are no longer as saleable in the contemporary economy are holding back. A lot of it has to do with the performance of our K-12 public schools, which in many of our cities continues to leave much to be desired. I think it's important to note that the educational reform that was so successful in the early 90s that provides in most cases upwards 80-90% of the funds for our urban public schools. I don't know what the figure is in Brockton, but I suspect the local contribution to the foundation budget is comparatively modest. The Foundation Budget Commission found that given rising health care costs for employees, services for special education students, and transportation expenses, things that are tough to manage your way through, currently the state support is not adequate to meet that constitutionally minimum level of local contribution. So, but it's also clear that the practices of schools really matter. This is some very interesting work done by my old colleagues at the UMass Donahue Institute and Mass Inc., a Boston-based think tank that focuses very much on the gateway cities, showing the share of students in public high schools that are making their way through high school, completing, going into public higher education, and completing within 6 years. And as you can see, some of our communities are doing a good job on that score, some of them are not. And so many of these communities are facing the same kinds of challenges, entrenched long-term multi-generational poverty, English language learners, and all the social and economic challenges that go along with that. I think that it's time for a second round of education reform in Massachusetts focused on urban education. I think we need to take a hard look at the way that we fund it and whether or not that funding is adequate. I think the evidence I've seen to date suggests that it isn't, but then I think there are also efforts that need to be made on the local level to improve outcomes. And I think focusing on what we need to achieve, that is, as many people as possible graduating from high school and as many that are capable and inclined to go on to public higher education or private higher education, whichever is most appropriate for them, makes sense. Clearly, giving options and opportunities and raising aspirations is part of the challenge, but we've got some real significant resource gaps. Of course, all of this is happening in a somewhat uncertain and volatile global economy. I mentioned at the outset that the nation is growing faster than the world and that that's not so impressive necessarily. We've had an extremely sluggish global recovery from the crisis, the Great Recession that began in late 2007, early 2008, and it's been a real decline in trade activity. Most here in Massachusetts, trade is a relatively small part of our economy, but we do rely on exports. We trade very intensely, particularly with Canada, so lots of talk going on now about whether NAFTA is a good idea. It's working out for Massachusetts so far. Particularly, we forget that North America includes two other countries, not just one. So we like to trade with our friends in Canada. We like to buy their stuff. They like to buy our stuff. I think it would be good if we could try to keep it that way. But overall, the global economy, particularly as a result of the drop in oil prices that has started to reverse itself recently, has really harmed those nations and in the U.S., those states that rely on fossil fuel and natural resource wealth. So when the economy slows, you don't buy as many inputs, you don't need as much fuel, the price drops, it doesn't make sense to frack anymore, it doesn't make sense to extract or purchase oil from places like Venezuela or the Middle East, not exactly the most stable parts of the world. And so they're not buying stuff from us, we're not buying stuff from them, and those forces combine to, I think, exert some downward pressure, shall we say, on global economic growth. So globally, we're a bit stuck and have been there for a while. A lot of the geopolitical developments, which I'll talk about in a moment, are not helping. At the same time, the innovation economy, it's becoming clear, both giveth and taketh away. So I don't know how you all satisfied your need to purchase things over the holiday season, regardless of which holiday or which holidays you're celebrating. I can tell you, I've been recycling more cardboard in my house than I ever saw as a child. We have been seeing downward pressure on the state sales tax receipts. Amazon is now collecting sales tax, but many other online retailers aren't. That's certainly something that bears monitoring. I would point out, too, that we're living in an age where it's possible to create vast amounts of wealth without employing a ton of people. These are two firms, two largest retailers in the world, the Walmart Corporation, which we can have arguments about, but employs several million people in the United States, and Amazon, which is doing its best to hire and is hiring like gangbusters in Stoughton and in Fall River and starting to build out its technology workforce in the Boston area. But their workforce pales in comparison to that of Amazon. Those firms have essentially, at the time this chart was captured, the same market cap. I think now Amazon is worth significantly more than, at least according to Wall Street. Those of you that are younger than me probably are familiar with WhatsApp, an application that goes on the phone that's very popular, hundreds of millions of users, maybe over a billion. Facebook bought them for $18 billion. They had a staff that developed that product that could fit in this room. Maybe, right? So 50, 60, 70 people made a thing that's worth $18 billion and they sold it and now they get to keep it. But usually an $18 billion enterprise looks like the Sony Corporation, right? A couple hundred thousand employees, real estate, lawyers, accountants. Not I built an app with my friends and I sold it for several billion dollars and now I own an island. There's nothing wrong with any of that. It's just the mechanism that we've relied upon to create economic opportunities is somebody makes a bunch of money, and then they have to spend that money to continue to make it. And technology is starting to change that equation. When driverless cars come, I'm going to be first in line because I drive about 30,000 miles a year. But I used to be a cab driver, so I know where that's leading, right? So Uber's driver partners will not be partners the minute that they don't have to need them. So the work displacing effects of technology are making things very efficient, and I don't think we're going back. But this connection between growth and economic development is starting to get a little bit murky around technology and innovation. I still think we benefit more than it costs. But just like trade and just like a number of the developments that I've mentioned this morning, there are winners and there are losers, and the folks that have been displaced are not terribly happy about it, and I don't think that problem is going away. Of course, we are also living in an incredibly volatile world geopolitically. This is a bit dated now, but it essentially is a nice summary of the risks as different people around the world see them. Right? We're afraid of terrorism. I don't know that that's our biggest threat, but it's certainly the one that causes us to lose sleep. Many of our neighbors to the south are worried about climate change. Those countries that are next to Russia and Iran are worried about them. The Middle East is worried about any number of things, as we well know. I suspect if we did this today, a number of these places would be worried about us now. Right? But my larger point is that, you know, what's going to happen? I don't know. And I think that's not good as far as predictability and certainty that are kind of cornerstones of the things that you look for when you want to make investments and raise the stakes a bit. But those are things we can't control. What will the president do? I'm not sure. What will the Iranians and the Russians? I'm not sure. Probably not good. We'll see what happens. But closer to home, we do have some things that are slowing us down that I think we can do something about if we have the will. This shows, I think, very starkly, if you take a careful look at it, sort of the price of not investing in basic roads, right? So at current pace, if we don't start spending more on basic road maintenance in Massachusetts, the smoothness, or lack of smoothness, of our roads will continue to deteriorate. And so the pressure on our transportation systems, and I deliberately chose not to pick the T, which obviously has demonstrated the needs for some more investment and, yes, better management, but I don't know how to manage my way out of a 50-year-old car, right? We need to replace those things. This shows us that, you know, steady levels of investment in infrastructure are having diminishing returns, and I want to make it clear that we pay for poor roads whether we repair them or not. A brief story, if I may. So during that terrible winter a couple of years ago, I picked up my son at a train station, doing the right thing, drove through a pothole in a very prosperous suburban community that I will not name, and lost a tire, right? It was a very deep pothole. So I go I'm towed to the shop, they're replacing the tire, it's a few $100s. I'm angry, as you would be, and I'm doing the math. How much gas tax would I have to pay to have the equivalent of this tire replaced? And at 10 cents gas tax increase, which nobody is talking about, it's a multiple of the recent gas tax increase, it would take me 75,000 miles to spend as much money as I spent replacing my tire. Oh, and by the way, the road still has a hole in it. So my point is that nobody rides for free. And if we choose to not pay in one way, we're going to pay in another way, either through repairs to the car, congestion on the roads, unreliable public transportation, and all the costs. Remember, time is money, and your time is money, too. And so that's something I think we could do more. And the absence of that will is, I think, putting some downward pressure on state growth and prosperity. I know water is an issue around here. It's an issue in many parts of the state. My colleagues and I at the Public Policy Center are working in Provincetown, where there's the desperate need for growth, but not enough wastewater treatment capacity to do it safely. The Water Infrastructure Task Force at the state level, if we just talk about basic repair and maintenance of the infrastructure that we rely upon to provide us with clean water and to treat the not-so-clean water that we flush out of our homes and businesses every day, is in the double-digit billions of dollars. I'm a public employee who fully expects that the Commonwealth will honor its pension obligations to me, right? So there are some obligations there that we need to deal with, too. So we've got a lot of long-term issues that have large price tags associated with them that are very basic. Getting people to work and goods and services to market is a core function of government. Making sure when you turn on the water, clean water comes out of the tap, and not poisonous water or dirty water or illegally contaminated water. This is basic stuff. So we as a nation, we as a state, have not really done a good job in maintaining that basic infrastructure. We're coming to the end of, I think, a 40 or 50-year cycle of that, and the bill's coming due. There is talk nationally of an infrastructure program, no details. I think if it was done in a targeted way, it would be a tremendous advantage. Would have been nice 5 years ago when we had people who needed work. Now I think it's going to be a little tougher because notwithstanding some popular misconceptions, the labor market is actually operating at close to peak efficiency. That's why my colleagues and I at the Mass Benchmarks editorial board, Mass Benchmarks, for those of you that don't know, is a publication that is published by the University of Massachusetts system in collaboration with the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston. It is editorially independent, so this is not the point of view of either the University of Massachusetts or the Central Bank, but we basically said it's time to start thinking we've gotten to the point where the equation has shifted from the cost of making these investments are exceeded by the opportunity costs of not making those investments. So it is time to start talking about how we want to invest our scarce and precious public resources and our infrastructure and our educational opportunities. I think would be very, very wise investments, and I don't just say that as an employee of the public university, although it is something that we see every day, for sure. I think the other issue, and it's a less acute issue in this region, but it's a major threat for Massachusetts, regardless of your position on the science, is climate change and sea level rise. This is a picture of Scituate during a natural disaster that we like to call winter. Right? So this is pretty much every winter in Scituate. These homes are insured by the federal government, which means when that home is demolished, it will be rebuilt. You're welcome. Right? Thank you. Your dime. Right? So we subsidize insurance for building in dangerous areas in coastal Massachusetts. It's not just communities. Well, Marshfield. Do you know why they call it Marshfield? Right? So we built on wet land right up against the water, and now the sea level is rising, and storm surges make it impossible to continue to live there. If you think about the value of the land and the economic activity that occurs immediately adjacent to the coastline in Massachusetts, you think about our islands, places like Martha's Vineyard and Nantucket and even Little Gosnold, right? Those are places that are directly threatened by this. Certainly Boston and all of the development that's occurred in the wake of the big dig on the seaport, double-digit billions of dollars of commercial development at sea level on the water. GE built its headquarters at sea level on the water. I mean, I'm not a climate scientist, but this is a major economic problem. In Dartmouth, where our campus is located, there's a beautiful home, anybody who's looking for one, about $20 million. It's right on the point, has a bowling alley, if you like to bowl. And at some point, that home will be threatened by the sea level rise. I have no empathy for that homeowner, that they're on their own. But the town of Dartmouth receives $300,000 or $400,000 in tax payments from that particular taxpayer. So when that home is consumed by the sea, the town of Dartmouth is going to have itself a bit of a fiscal crisis. So start thinking about what the implications are for the land values along the coastline, and you can start to see what the potential threats are, not just to the physical environment and to the coastline, but to municipal finance and to individual wealth. And for a sneak preview, look into what's happening in Miami, where it floods every day, whether there's a rainstorm or not. So regardless of how one feels about this, it's happening. I don't think anybody knows how quickly it's going to happen. I don't think it's an overnight problem, which gives us some time to deal with it. But if we don't deal with it, the price of contending with these problems is only going to go up. And then, of course, we've got no values embedded in this, really. It's just, I think it's kind of what's going to happen Friday and Saturday. Apparently, the president-elect is taking the weekend off, so I'm not sure who's running the country on Saturday. But we don't know what's going to happen. And beyond the sort of, I can't stop watching those hearings on TV, I'll reserve comment maybe until Q&A, but for Massachusetts, the stakes are very high, right? And I'll conclude. So I've been thinking through what it might mean in the event that the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare is repealed. Now, Massachusetts is one of those states that was all in. We had a similar system before, and we were going to cover everybody, but the Affordable Care Act actually did a great thing for Massachusetts. It allowed us to expand Medicaid or MassHealth, which now covers about 2 million of our neighbors. 2 million. There's only about 6.8 million of us, so a large chunk of the population is on the Medicaid, rather, and expanded through the Affordable Care Act. There's several hundred thousand people. What happens if they repeal it? Well, historically, every dime the state spends on Medicaid, half of that comes back, because we're a high-income state. The Congress, in the last session, and still run by the same folks, basically wanted to turn that into a block grant. So instead of, we'll reimburse you for half of whatever your costs are, it's, here's your fixed amount, right? you know, spend it wisely, right? So if they reduced those subsidies, for the expansion, it's 100%. They're paying for everything. So if they take that away, which I think would be very extreme, then the states like ours that expanded Medicaid would be stuck with the whole bill, which the American Enterprise Institute estimated would be in the $3 to $3.5 billion of costs that would shift from the federal government back to our state in particular. Larger states like New York and California would be on the hook for, you know, much larger amounts, and it would force a conversation about whether or not we need to start restricting access to Medicaid or not. I know Governor Baker, and I've not had a chance to review the details, proposed some changes to the state Medicaid plan yesterday, including some potential fees for businesses that I suspect is being developed in anticipation of the elimination of the Affordable Care Act and a big shift in who's paying for health care. This by itself is a giant deal for Massachusetts. We've cut taxes by about $3 billion overall since the late 90s. We're no longer Taxachusetts. No matter how you measure it, we're in the middle of the pack when it comes to effective tax burden as a state. But we're in a kind of chronic shortfall when it comes to the budget because the cost of government services, particularly of delivering health care to people whose employers aren't providing it to them or who are lower or in Massachusetts moderate income, is growing very rapidly. And so I think this is one of a number of different problems that we're going to have to contend with at the local and the state level. It certainly has implications for municipal finance and the kind of benefits that are provided to our retirees, and ultimately the state's financial capacity. I find it hard to believe that the Congress would allow that to happen and that the representatives from the states that would be negatively affected would happen. I will note that the Medicaid expansion states, with the exception of, I think, Michigan, are not on the victory tour for the president-elect, so he may not be as concerned about our dissatisfaction as he might be about the dissatisfaction of others. But again, I think we're entering some very interesting and uncertain times. I think we have the wind at our back here in Massachusetts. I think the problems that we are facing that we have some control over are well within our power to solve if we have the will and the leadership to do so, and we have a long-term point of view. And I do think, and I want to end on a positive note, that Massachusetts is as well positioned as any state or region in the country to ride out whatever comes next, but I think we may be in for a bit of a bumpy ride. And with that, I will turn it over to the moderator, who will be happy to field questions on my behalf. Thank you. Okay. Apparently, I filibustered my way to pass the question, so I'm happy to hang out afterwards for anybody who had a particular one. But thank you so much for your time and attention.
I want to thank you for your great questions, and you probably assume that you're going to get a great answer. And Michael has great answers, and as he indicated, he'll stay around. As I went through the questions, I did note that many of the questions were addressed in his presentation, which was very thorough and very enjoyable to hear all of that. We thank you very much, Michael, for being with us this morning and sharing that with us. Now, before we close out, just a couple of chamber updates. We would invite all of you to attend our legislative luncheon, which will take place this year on Tuesday, February 21st at noon at the Conference Center at Massasoit in Brockton. The event will feature Congressman Joe Kennedy. Tickets and tables of 10 are available. Please see Athena Lavoie at the registration desk as you leave. And get ready for the 25th annual Taste of Metro South. It's hard to believe we've been doing that for 25 years. And it's great to see people who are coming back year after year. If you haven't been, you gotta go. It is truly one of the great events in the Metro South area year in and year out. So that'll take place on Wednesday, March 22nd at the Conference Center at Massasoit. It's a night of celebrating living, working, and enjoying the Metro South region. Tickets are on sale now, and it does sell out, so get your ticket. Please plan to purchase your tickets ahead of time, and you can also see Athena for that as well. Now we have a couple of door prizes. Once again, we will choose one company to be highlighted with a member profile in the action report. In this month's company is Jeff Johnson of Salem Media Group. Congratulations, Jeff. And for the door prize, it's a Stonehill tote bag and a gift pack, including a four-year full scholarship. I'm only kidding about that. Compliments of Stonehill College. And the winner is Mal Stanton McCooney, School on Wheels. Congratulations, Mal. And finally, just a quick thank you to everybody who made this possible, including our ambassador team, who do a great job all the time, Rob Peters Entertainment, Janet Trask for photographing today's event, the Martin Institute here at Stonehill, Brockton Community Access, The Enterprise, today's interviewer, Marcia Kanbobe, and also to our presenters this morning, Professor Deborah Salvucci from Stonehill and Professor Michael Goodman, UMass Dartmouth. Enjoy the rest of the day and make somebody smile. Thank you all for being here.